Over the past few months, we've spoken often about China's treatment of the Uyghur people in the massive Xinjiang region in the northwest of the country. Now, the ACT Party is asking our parliament to name it as genocide. Something similar has already been done in the UK and Canada. The government is so far hedging its bets, with the new Foreign Affairs Minister articulating a vision of diplomacy which speaks truth to power without provoking power to be punitive. The dragon and the Taniwha is the example she uses, which kind of means how can we take a just and moral position without imperiling a $20 billion export market. National's Jerry Brownlee suggests, and I quote, "The real question is what do we know about the circumstances there?" So let's answer that this morning, not for the first time, but it clearly needs repeating. And to do that, we're really grateful to welcome to breakfast a very special guest. Dr. Sophie Richardson is the China Director at Human Rights Watch. She's written extensively on Chinese domestic and foreign policy and why they do what they do, and she's testified before the European Parliament and the US Senate and the US House of Representatives. Morena, Dr. Richardson, it is really wonderful to have you with us on Breakfast. Thank you for joining us.
It's great to be with you.
Yeah, we're delighted to have somebody who knows so much about this. I'm fascinated by the declaration of genocide, and this is something that Human Rights Watch is looking at. And one of the questions you ask is the necessary genocidal intent. It looks like genocide, doesn't it? The treatment of the Uyghurs is grotesque and cynical and outrageous. So how is it not genocide yet if it isn't?
Well, it's good to be with you if discussing this grim topic. You know, the reality is that actually pursuing a prosecution of genocide, and there have been very few cases that have actually gone to court, requires demonstrating a high degree of intent on a state's part, and showing that is a real challenge. And what we've said recently is that these are indisputably crimes against humanity, and we may yet come to a determination of genocide, but we haven't been able to show that. But what we think is incredibly important is, first of all, you know, Parliament's taking these steps as a way of recognizing Uyghurs' nightmare, but also for states like New Zealand to keep pushing for an independent investigation under the UN's auspices with a view towards gathering evidence, you know, and considering steps towards accountability, which is what would happen in lots of other countries that are less powerful.
And the CCP is simply not letting people in, right? So the investigation would need to be independent, and they would need to have access.
Yeah, well, the access debate has become a little bit of a diplomatic cul-de-sac with UN actors, because the UN has asked for unfettered access to the region, and the Chinese government has said, how about fettered access? And they've sort of gone back and forth. And the reality is that most of the kinds of investigations that we're talking about that have been quite successful actually wind up taking place outside the country in question anyway, because the government won't let them in. This is the case for North Korea, for Venezuela, for the Rohingya from Myanmar. And so the trick now is really to move the discussion to gathering evidence outside China. And there's plenty to be had.
I've been reading Break Their Lineage, Break Their Roots, which is available on Human Rights Watch's website. I really recommend it. And boy, some of the stuff that is described in there, Dr. Richardson, is just terrible. And I just want to talk about what Human Rights Watch described as a particularly chilling practice. Some Turkic Muslim children, of whom Uyghurs are the main group, I think, whose parents have been arbitrarily detained, are placed in state institutions such as orphanages. So they're not orphans, but they are made orphans by the state and then placed in state orphanages. This is just a... And the arbitrary detention of their parents simply for holding religious views in some cases. This is terrible, isn't it?
Yeah, Uyghurs are being detained essentially because they're Uyghurs. And you know, there's no legal basis for their detention whatsoever. And some of these cases of family separation are excruciating, because we're talking about children as young as 3 or 4 who are not just institutionalized, but they're institutionalized in facilities where they're really only spoken to in Chinese to eradicate their Uyghur language skills. They're clearly not being raised in ways that are consistent with their family's Muslim faith. And as you point out, they have family members. You know, it became policy in the region in 2018 that any child who is not with a parent was meant to be institutionalized. So even if there were grandparents or aunts or uncles or other extended family, and we think this is fairly clearly designed to, as the quote indicates, break their roots and break their lineage to really eradicate this distinct identity.
That's genocide, isn't it? Surely.
Well, we're working on showing that. But again, you know, I think people get a little bit tied up in the debate of terminology. And let's be clear, crimes against humanity are among the most serious under international law. The trick is to end the Chinese government's sense of impunity and actually envision prosecuting people.
Yeah, right. Okay. And that leads us to the really important question. How the hell do we do that? Given that, given that this is a country that remorselessly and unembarrassed gave us Tiananmen Square, given that President Xi just stares everyone down, how does the world do this?
Right. Well, there are a couple of different tracks to follow, and one of them begins with a UN-backed investigation. But there are other options, too. You know, most democracies consider crimes against humanity eligible for what's known as universal jurisdiction cases. So in theory, somebody could be prosecuted in a democracy for crimes against humanity that were committed in another country, as has just happened in Germany with Syrians who were alleged to have tortured others. And, you know, given the scope and the scale of these crimes, this is one strategy we strongly encourage governments to consider.
Final question. Gosh, I'm enjoying your company, and this is a fantastic insight. Thank you. We always talk about China as if the CCP was China, right? And we know the CCP is not China. In fact, the CCP ruthlessly imposes itself on the Chinese people. We can see this in Hong Kong at the moment. Do the Chinese people know what's happening? Do the Chinese people, away from the Xinjiang region, and it's huge, and there are people thousands of kilometres away from it within China, know that this is going on? And if so, what do they think?
Very few do because of state censorship, but there have been some interesting cracks in that armor recently, both in the furore over companies, foreign firms that had expressed concerns about forced labor in Xinjiang, and the censors let people talk a little bit about Xinjiang for a few days, mostly with a view towards stirring up nationalist sentiment. But one of the net effects we noticed was that more Chinese netizens were suddenly asking, what is going on in Xinjiang? What's happening there? Why can't we get more information? But also now on platforms like Clubhouse, for example, when you can actually have free conversations between people in the mainland and Uyghurs who can share these horrific stories of what's happened to their family members, there's actually an enormous amount of sympathy. And in that sense, I think people across the mainland who had full access to free and diverse information would probably be horrified to know that this was happening.
We so appreciate you joining us this morning. I really recommend going to Human Rights Watch website. Break Their Lineage, Break Their Roots is the report. You'll find it very easily. Final question, and you've got about 4 seconds to answer this, otherwise I'll be fired, which may not be a bad thing, but should New Zealand Parliament declare this genocide? Would that be helpful?
Well, I think showing that kind of concern for the community and the diaspora helps, for sure.
Dr. Sophie Richardson, who is in charge of China, for want of a better term, for Human Rights Watch, we so appreciate you joining us this morning. Thank you so much for
Thanks
your time.
For having me.
It's a pleasure.